Hello, anatomy colleagues. This is Dr. Alsup, and we have finally made it to the muscles of the lower limb. And we're going to start with the gluteal region muscles, which are kind of covering two bases, but they are going to affect the hip joint. So talking about them with the lower limb makes the most sense. So we'll talk about the three main muscles in this region, and we'll talk a little bit about a specific clinical correlation at the end. So starting with the big one, the gluteus maximus, this is our most superficial gluteal muscle. I'm outlining it right now. It is also our largest, it's our most coarsely fibered, it's the heaviest muscle of the body. So this muscle is no joke. It is going to be very obvious in terms of its superficial position as well as just the general size of this muscle. And it will actually cover all the other gluteal muscles. So you won't be able to see the medius or minimus at all, except you do see a little bit of the gluteus medius extending superiorly just above the gluteus maximus, but it's very covered with what's referred to as gluteal fascia. But you can see a little peak of the gluteus medius, and you can't see any gluteus minimus unless the gluteus maximus has been reflected. The majority of the fibers of the gluteus maximus will insert or have its distal attachment on the iliotibial band, which will be located on the lateral portion of the lower limb. And we'll talk a bit more about the iliotibial band when we get into some muscles of the thigh region. This is going to play a big role here. And since it's inserting here, it'll play a role in terms of extension of the hip, which we'll get to in a bit more detail in a moment. Now, some of the other muscle fibers will have a more inferior attachment at the gluteal tuberosity of the femur. But since the majority is going to have an insertion here, that's what I want you to focus on. And you can see this particular image says iliotibial band. You'll also see an iliotibial tract. Okay, this muscle has its own innervation. So it has a separate innervation from the gluteus medius and minimus. So it will be the inferior gluteal nerve. And it will also be supplied by the inferior gluteal artery as well as the superior gluteal artery. And that kind of neurovascular supply will enter into the deep portion of the muscle at about the mid portion of the muscle. And the gluteus maximus will be the main extensor of the hip joint, or the most powerful or strongest extensor of the hip joint. But it really only is going to be active in cases where you need more forceful extension. So think for when you're rising from a standing position or from if you're jumping in that way, it's not really going to be playing as much of a role when you're just kind of standing. And while your hip is extended, it's not the gluteus maximus that's playing the bigger role in terms of that movement or that stance. So it's really for more of that forceful extension of the hip joint. It'll also play an important role in terms of lateral rotation of the hip. The gluteus medius and minimus, as I mentioned, will be deep to the gluteus maximus, except for this kind of top portion of the gluteus medius. And these muscles are, as their names would suggest, indicative of their size. So the medius will be kind of intermediate in size in comparison to the gluteus maximus and minimus, and the minimus will be the smallest one. But they are both going to have kind of a similar shape, even though the minimus won't extend as superiorly. And they both will be inserting or having their distal attachment on the greater trochanter of the femur. And that's one of the major reasons why the greater trochanter is so large in comparison to, say, the lesser trochanter or any other tubercles, because these are also very powerful, forceful muscles. And they play a very important role in terms of stabilizing the hip. And it does so through abduction and medial rotation of the hip, but it's really this abduction that allows for the gluteus medius and minimus when they contract to allow for the hip to not dip to one side. So it's really playing a role in terms of stabilization. And where the gluteus maximus is going to be innervated by the inferior gluteal, the minimus and medius will be innervated by the superior gluteal nerve. So if you have injury to that superior gluteal nerve, you can have what is a presentation of that could be what's referred to as the gluteal gait or gluteus medius limp. And this is what happens to kind of compensate for weakened abduction. So say you have some type of damage to the superior gluteal nerve on this right side. This would not allow for this right gluteus medius and minimus to contract to allow for this stabilization that typically happens when you lift your foot off the ground. So in this particular case, in the typical case, the superior gluteal nerve is not injured. It allows for the right medius and minimus to contract when you lift up your left foot, and that when it contracts, it will abduct and allow for stabilization of the hip. Whereas if you do not have that contraction occurring with these muscles, it would allow for the hip to dip on the uninjured side because this side is not stabilizing. So oftentimes this is this sign of this dip would be referred to as a positive Trendelenburg sign or test. And it causes that lower limb to almost appear too long. It has a hard time kind of clearing the ground because the pelvis has dipped to that one side because you don't have the compensation of the medius and minimus on the other side contracting. Okay, excellent. So innervation seemed key here, and we spent a lot of time on superior gluteal nerve, but what does that inferior gluteal nerve innervate? Which muscle here? Is it the maximus, medius, or minimus? And I'm just going to give you a second, because hopefully this is a nice quick recall. But recall the medius and minimus are going to be superior gluteal nerve. So that was where that Trendelenburg sign and gluteal gait, if you have injury to the superior gluteal nerve. The gluteus maximus has its own innervation, which is the inferior gluteal nerve, and so that makes this the correct option. Okay, excellent. Thank you so much for your time and attention here. We will now move on to the muscles of the thigh region, and there's quite a few compartments there that we have to work through. Have a fun time reviewing this material. Please reach out if you have any specific questions, and I hope you have a great rest of your day.